first live televised all candidates debate in the race for mayor of the civic election for Winnipeg for 2014. We're coming to you from the Franco-Manitobain Cultural Center here in St. Boniface, live on Shaw TV Cable 9 and live stream on globalnews.ca/Winnipeg. My name is Peter Chura from Global News. I will be the moderator for tonight. The debate format, three rounds of questions for all seven of our candidates for mayor in the 2014 civic election. We'll have questions from our media panelists. We'll have questions from you, the public, both on the street on camera and on Twitter. And of course, the final round, the candidate-to-candidate debate, where they will challenge each other with questions. Also tonight, we have a crowd at the King's Head Pub in downtown Winnipeg watching events unfold on TV there. We'll be hearing from them throughout the night as well with some questions. Questions will probably get better as the night goes on. Now, for those of you watching from home, you can join in the debate as well anytime. If you're on Twitter, just tweet us at Shaw TV Winnipeg. Use the hashtag YourMayor. You can make your observations on the debate, who you think is winning, and of course, contribute your questions that may be used live on the air. So, like I said, all seven of our candidates for mayor are here tonight. The order in which they are seated to my right was decided randomly at a draw earlier this week. Let's introduce them. We have Gord Steeves on the left, Judy Wasylycia-Leis, Paula Havixbeck, Mitch Fillion, David Sanders, Robert-Falcon, Ouellette, and Brian Bowman. Now, to help move us along in the debate here, I've brought along some friends and colleagues in the media. They'll be asking questions in our first round of the debate and also throughout the night. Now with me tonight are Bartley Kivas from the Winnipeg Free Press, Marcy Ragusa from CBC Radio, and Colin Fast from the Metro Winnipeg. But first, let's start with the candidates in your opening statements. Now, first of all, you've all agreed, of course, to the debate format to move things along. We've got some pretty strict time limits that you've all agreed to, 90 seconds each for your opening statements. We'll do this in the order that your seating order was randomly picked as well. Starting with Gord Steeves tonight. Mr. Steeves.
Thank you very much. All right, I respect all of my council, all of my mayoralty colleagues running for council, running for mayor. This is, however, a mayoralty contest based on clear choices. In my opinion, based on taxation and money. I am not going to raise your taxes. Two of my colleagues, Brian Bauman, Judy Wasylycia-Leis, are going to raise your taxes. I have faced some criticism for my decision not to raise your taxes. I could do this because I am not going to build bus rapid transit. My colleagues Judy and Brian are. On September 2nd, Brian Bauman pledged to build not just one, but six phases of bus rapid transit. The projects that Judy and Brian are proposing with respect to bus rapid transit are going to cost hundreds of millions, if not billions, of dollars. If I was building bus rapid transit, I could not freeze your property taxes. Here in Winnipeg, if you live here, with all four levels of government and taxation, we pay among the highest taxes of any citizens in the country of Canada. At what stage do we say enough is enough? We have to be very, very careful about our levels of taxation because our levels of taxation, in my opinion, are driving people away from our city. I have nothing against BRT. In fact, I was one of the proponents of the first leg of the project. However, now is not the time to build a $600 million, $1 billion project for BRT. We need to focus on our roads. I look forward to the debate. Thank you.
Judy Wasylycia-Leis.
Thanks, Peter. And I want to thank Winnipeg Realtors and Shaw TV for this opportunity. Winnipeg is an incredibly amazing city. We have a rich multicultural diversity, deep Aboriginal roots, an ability to come together in times of difficulty and resilience par excellence, and an art scene that is unparalleled anywhere in this country. Imagine what we can be if our city is working with us and in partnership with all of these great innovators in Winnipeg. Imagine what this city could be if we actually started putting in place programs that fix the foundations of the city and start to deal with the crumbling infrastructure. We've got potholes par excellence, don't we? We've got crumbling sidewalks and frozen pipes. And we've got a city hall that is not functional. In fact, it has a culture of secrecy, lacking in transparency and accountability. And Winnipeggers have lost trust, or are rapidly losing trust in their own city government. So I have a plan that is practical and based on my experience in working in public and political life. It's a plan to put $400 million over 4 years into our infrastructure to reduce our infrastructure deficit. It does mean an affordable tax increase that's based on cost of living and population growth. It's a plan that puts in place accountability Winnipeg to ensure integrity is restored. It's a plan to actually protect services and a plan to create opportunities for our young people. Thank you.
Right to time. Thank you. Next, Paula Havixbeck.
Thank you for having me here today, and we're here in the heart of St. Boniface. And je parle un peu français un peu, mais vous ne voudriez pas entendre mes français. So the rest will be in English. But I would like to also thank the Shaw TV for putting on today, and the Winnipeg Realtors. If you remember nothing else tonight about me, remember this acronym, TIPS. I too want to keep taxes low, and I fought against tax increases in my time on council. I have a plan for infrastructure. I have a plan that addresses the deferred short-term type of issues that we see on a day-to-day basis, as well as a 20-year plan that's going to address things like frozen pipes and roads that are continuing to break down. Part of my plan includes poverty. That's the P in the TIPS. Addressing the issues, because we have many social issues that drive crime and safety, and that's the latter piece of my plan, is to address safety in our city so that we live in the safest city in Canada, and we take pride in the vibrancy that we have, and we can do this together and accomplish this together. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Havixbeck. Michel Fillion.
The job of a mayor is to serve and to protect. Today, I will talk to you about protect on an emergency at a large scale. It has been a thought that I have been having for a long time. Since the tensions between countries are climbing with the years, I am always wondering about war sirens. They did exist during the Second World War. The question I ask is, do we still have some in this city? Where are they? Are they still operational? It is ultimately important to protect ourselves in the event of a conflict. Now, if they are operational, I would like the citizens of Winnipeg to be familiar with the sound. The drill would be publicly pre-announced to prevent flight. Another question I ask is, if I get a call from Ottawa, from the Minister of Defense, and tells me, Mitch, you have 2 hours to evacuate your city. Do we have an evacuation plan? I seriously doubt it, because the citizens would already be informed. It is the job of a mayor to protect the city as a whole. With the unrest in the world, and when we hear about the possibility of imposing acts in our country, mayors are implemented. It is the right of every citizen in Winnipeg to have warning and an evacuation plan in place. If this was thought about already in the past, it has been disregarded, probably for the reason of fear. We do not want our citizens to be afraid.
All right, Mr. Fillion, I have to cut you off there. Your time is up, and we move on to David Sanders for his opening statement.
Hello, Peter. And hello, everyone else looking on tonight. I'm David Saunders. I'm running for mayor of the city of Winnipeg. I am a native Winnipegger. I love this city. And I have, during the last 2 years, made a special effort to watch and review and comment on the goings-on at City Hall. I've spent most of my life trying to make this a good and effective city government. As a journalist, as a longtime civil servant in the provincial government, as a real estate agent for 12 years, as a university teacher, as a tax consultant in property tax assessment. And so I'm very familiar with how this city should work and how great it can be. But unfortunately, the scandals of the last 2 years are painful to watch and important that they be fixed. And that's why I'm running, because I believe that this work must be done. City Hall needs to be fixed. It needs to be overhauled immediately in order that we can get on and be the city we want to be and do all the wonderful things that all of my fellow colleagues here are at promising for. Until we fix City Hall, it's not going to happen. I'm looking forward to having the support of the public in order to do the job that needs to be done starting in November. Thank you.
David Saunders, thanks very much. Next up, Robert-Falcon, Ouellette, his opening statement tonight.
Merci, mes concitoyens et concitoyennes, de nous accueillir ici dans le cœur de la francophonie de l'Amérique du Nord. C'est aussi le lieu de naissance de ma famille. I use this language because it's a demonstration of the type of city that we must have here in the city of Winnipeg, a city of diversity and also of great respect, a city where we can rub shoulders together and live together. My vision for our city is a long-term vision of good city planning based on science and fact. This is the most important election in two generations, and we have to have a better city not only for a few citizens, but all citizens. I am proposing plans such as a better transit system, but also about how we can actually work together to actually create that united city. We need a mayor who has real leadership experience, and I have exercised that leadership experience through 18 years in the Canadian Armed Forces. I also understand how cities function because I've been researching and looking into them and understanding them for the past 4 years concerning the city of Winnipeg, but since 2004, trying to understand cities across North America and in Canada. What we need in the city most of all is a mayor who can be a mayor for everyone. Yes.
Our final opening statement from Brian Bowman.
Thank you very much, Peter, and thank you everyone at home for watching. It's a pleasure to be here tonight. My name's Brian Bowman. I'm a 43-year-old husband and father of two young boys. In my day job, I am a business lawyer with a specialization in privacy, access to information, and social media law. And so what that means is I work with the victims of cyberbullying, I work to defend people's rights, and I work to get information out of government time in and time and again. Winnipeg is at a crossroads, and this election is about the future. The Winnipeg way, the way that we've been able to build such a strong city, is by getting people working together. And we lost that over the last number of years. And I'd like to lead the cause at City Hall to get people working again. My vision for Winnipeg is to build a city of 1 million people strong. The Conference Board of Canada predicts that Winnipeg's population will reach 1 million people in about 20 years. And I'd like to not just sit passively by, but actually work to plan a city better for 1 million people. My focus is on three areas: having a City Hall that works with greater openness and transparency, focusing on a growing, thriving, more modern Winnipeg with modern infrastructure, and also focusing in on stronger and safer neighborhoods. You have a choice in this election between an old school politician who's been around for decades or a new generation of leadership, a positive approach to move us forward. I have the experience, I have the passion, and I look forward to the debate tonight. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Those are opening statements. I don't know if you'll notice my friends in the media panel have been both frowning and making notes. So we'll hear after the break some questions from our media panelists, also online, and from you, the viewer. And we'll go head-to-head later on in the debate with questions, candidates challenging each other directly. You're watching Your Mayor live on Shaw TV. We are back live with Your Mayor, the only televised all-candidates debate in the race for mayor in Winnipeg's civic election of 2014. It is time for our first round of questions. This is the media round. Bart Kivas from the Winnipeg Free Press, Marcy Marcusa from CBC Radio, and Colin Fast from the Metro Winnipeg will be posing questions. There are three topics: infrastructure, taxes, and integrity at City Hall. Now again, there's only a limited amount of time here for the broadcast, so to be as fair as possible to the discussion of each topic, not all candidates will have the opportunity to respond to each question. Throughout the broadcast, candidates will have 60 seconds to respond to these questions and all the questions that come up everywhere. So we begin with infrastructure and transit, starting with Bartley Kivas from the Winnipeg Free Press.
Judy, you have a proposed property tax hike that would barely keep pace with the rising cost of city services. It certainly wouldn't raise enough revenue to pay for the billions that we need to raise to fix infrastructure. So could you please give us a credible plan? What is your actual plan to fix all the roads, replace all the combined sewers, and do everything else?
Thanks, Bartley. I think I've got a very credible and practical plan to begin to address this huge infrastructure deficit, which, as you know, is about $7.4 billion. So we've got to start, we've got to have a plan. I propose actually a $400 million four-year plan, which is based on an affordable property tax increase. You're right, 3% a year is not going to raise a lot of money, but if we invest it properly and if we use that money for paying for borrowing, we can actually increase the amount of blocks we can repair to about 1,000, and we can actually add $60 million a year based on that proposal. It's a start. It's not the whole thing. You're right. We're going to have to get our own house in order, though, to use the tools we have at our disposal, and then go forward and with credibility and legitimacy talk to our provincial and federal counterparts to be a partner in this big, big challenge.
The city already spends more than $100 million a year on the capital side of the budget, so I don't get it. Is there some other means? Because that property tax hike is just barely going to cover that decent fire paramedic stuff.
We're taking that. I'm going to take 2% of that 3% proposed tax increase and put it towards, not cash, but towards paying the interest on borrowing money.
You are aware the city already does something.
They do that, and they don't do enough of it. We can do more. We can take a bigger bite out of our infrastructure deficit at the front end without changing our credit ratings, without getting any threatening notes from the bond rating agencies. We've got the ability to do more, and Winnipeggers, I think, are willing to do their part as long as they know their hard-earned taxpayers' dollars are going towards fixing potholes and bringing accountability to City Hall.
Quick question, what do you think's in the roads budget this year, 2014?
There's about 340.
Just roads.
Just roads?
Yes.
Well, there's 340 in capital overall. I think it's about 60 for roads.
It's about 80.
Yeah.
Here
so absolutely, there's lots more to do, partly, and I think we have to make a stab and get us on the right path.
Okay, next question from Marcy Marcuse.
Brian, we know you said you want to go big on rapid transit by 2030. You want to complete all of the phases. This is a multi-billion dollar promise. We also have heard you say how you'll do it. You've talked about getting taxes from new developments to help pay for these lines. But we also know that the developments that are already around some of these lines, at Fort Rouge, there's a development that stalled. I did interviews with people this week. Also, another development stalled at Confusion Corner. How can you be so sure to bank on development that is so unproven, especially when developers hate uncertainty?
Well, thank you very much for the question, Marcy. And the reason why it hasn't worked out the way that it's been built is because we haven't had the political leadership in place to actually see it through. I ask you, would you actually want to invest in building a townhouse or an apartment block along phase two of rapid transit yourself? Would any Winnipegger would, with the political leadership that we've had at City Hall? What we've seen in other cities, places like Cleveland, places like Portland, and many other cities, is that when the political leadership is steadfast and gives investors the confidence that there actually is going to be a return on your investment, they will build. We talk about wanting to create a denser city.
Isn't it a big gamble, though? If you build it, they will come? I mean, this is billions of dollars.
Well, it's been demonstrated. If you look at the Healthline, for instance, in Cleveland, of all places, they had most of the developments built years before the line actually went in, and they did that in order to help pay for it. The other thing that I've tried to do during this campaign, and would love the opportunity to pursue if given the chance to serve Winnipeggers, is to try to get our fair share from the PST increase. That's something I'm the only candidate who's been really speaking about, fighting for the PST increase that we've had here in Winnipeg and across Manitoba. 1% raise in the PST, collected over $154 million from Winnipeggers over the last year. It's supposed to be for infrastructure, and we get $50 million back.
How are you going to do that when everybody else has tried to do that before and no one's done that? What makes you think you can do that?
Well, what I'm going to do is I've wanted to create something called the Build Winnipeg Partnership. One of the key challenges right now to dealing with infrastructure and the way that the politicians who've been there have been rolling it out is ad hoc measures by different levels of government, political interference, especially phase two is a great example of where political interference gets in the way, and by lack of coordination between active transportation, roads, and public transit. The Build Winnipeg Partnership that I've proposed would seek participation from the province. So that was one of my first announcements when it comes to infrastructure.
Both Sam Cates and Glenn Murray, both went to the province seeking the same thing. This has gone on year over year. So what is different about you that you're going to see this come through?
Well, I have a proven track record of being able to work with the different levels of government. When it comes to the provincial government, our current provincial government, I worked, when I was leader of the Winnipeg Chamber of Commerce, I worked with NIM, as well as the province of Manitoba, to secure a World Trade Center license for Winnipeg. I can work across different parties and get results, and I've proven that I've been able to do that in the past, and I'd love the opportunity to do it. But question is, do you want a leader for the city that isn't even going to fight for a fair share of that PST increase? And that's what I offer that's uniquely different as compared to some of the other candidates.
All right, thank you, Mr. Bowman. We're going to move on now to Colin Fast from the Metro Winnipeg.
Robert, your transit plan might actually make Brian's look a bit modest. You've talked about removing all of the rail traffic out of the city, and ultimately replacing that with light rapid transit. But we don't know what the cost of the new lines is going to be, what the cost of the new rail yards is going to be, what it's going to cost for the land for those new lines and rail yards, what the LRT is going to cost, and the railways have no interest in this plan. So at a certain point, this starts to sound like the monorail episode of The Simpsons. aren't you kind of selling a vision that has no price tag attached to it? And as mayor, you'd have limited ability to actually enact.
Well, I don't know if we need to think in a small vision for the city of Winnipeg. I think what we need is actually to think long-term for the city. And this is what I've been proposing, I've been talking about, is actually long-term city planning. And so when you consider the BRT, I don't believe it's actually the appropriate way to go forward. It doesn't give the proven economic benefits nor the environmental benefits. Pouring concrete is not very good for the environment. And so I would not continue that. I would actually reorganize the bus system along a metro line or a metro bus system like in Quebec City or Montreal or Vancouver or even Seoul, Korea, in order to produce a more efficient bus system where the buses would come every 5 to 15 minutes along two main arteries. Then once that is done, to actually study rail relocation. How many people have actually, or how many studies can we actually cite that have actually gone into depth to actually look at it and understand it appropriately? We know here in the city of Winnipeg that we have so many dangerous goods that are moving through this city day after day, literally dangerous goods such as oil. And there was just recently a train derailment in Saskatchewan that demonstrates once again, we don't need these goods moving right through this neighborhood right here in St. Boniface, right behind me.
But isn't this a problem that's occurring across the country? There's cities and towns, thousands of them across Canada.
And Regina's just recently done and removed the rail lines, and in the process of moving those rail lines outside of their downtown core. And I think if we sit here in Winnipeg and we think a long-term vision, like the aqueduct, like the floodway, let's actually understand it, how much it's going to cost. And rail lines aren't that expensive when you move them outside into the farmlands, because when you're expropriating farmland, really it's about 1.3 to 2 million. And you say, well, the rail executives, we haven't talked to them. Well, how has anyone really actually sat down with them and had a serious discussion about it? Has anyone actually?
But shouldn't that discussion take place before we start selling a vision and telling people that this is what we're going
to
do?
Well, what I'm saying here, what I'm saying is what we need to do is study it and research it and understand it. And if we don't do that, then we can't even put this on the table to discuss it. And I think if we continually to push it to the side, because no one sat down with the rail executives in a serious manner, I think we're doing a large disservice as any leader, anyone who's sitting in that mayor's chair, because the cost of BRT is so expensive. It is really, literally going to cripple the city in the long term. And I think the cost...
But it's going to cost billions to follow through with your plan.
How do you know that? Have you ever studied it? Do you have those cost proposals? That is a complete falsity, and it is not true.
Rail transportation engineers say that. When
well, it's cost $1.3 to $2 million per rail mile. And this is what I've had discussions with.
How much would it cost to build the shops out of town, Robert? To rebuild the shops that are at the CPR yards and everywhere else. What do you think what that would cost?
It's not. But here's the thing about this. The Rail Relocation Act actually indicates that 50% of those costs will be paid for by the federal government.
No, that's incorrect.
Yeah, we're talking a lot about costs here, and that could bring us to our next topic area of taxes. Condole infrastructure. Our next topic area for a media panel is taxes, beginning with Bartley Kivas addressing Gord Steeves.
Yeah, I thought I was going to be mean, but then Colin asked that last one. Gord, Gord Steeves, you've proposed a property tax freeze with no service cuts and no job losses. You couldn't do that when you're on council, when you actually cut middle management jobs and whittle back on services. So how could you possibly do that as mayor?
Well, I guess I'd like to start with the premise that we don't have an unlimited ability to tax in this city. So if we look at our $1.5 billion budget, as you're aware, if we increase property taxes by 2%, it adds an additional $8 million on top of the $1.5 billion. Every year for 11 years when I froze property taxes or I cut them, people would say the exact same thing that you were saying to me. and we would look through the budget, detailed line by detailed line by detailed line. Every year we made it work. And I know what you're saying. You're saying the one year with the WOPSO cuts, that we actually did cut some positions. That was
80 positions.
Well, I guess if that is in fact accurate, there are going to be some times where we cannot bring along all of our people in terms of our complement. The point is, do we have an unlimited ability to tax?
I'm just asking you how. I wasn't asking you to give me a rhetorical question. I was asking you to tell me how you were going to do this.
The difficult part about answering your question is that the only way to possibly do it is the same way that I did it for 11 years in a row. We started 6 months in advance. We went through the budget document. You were there, standing outside talking to us. And we went through the budget, and every year we succeeded in balancing the budget and not losing people, except for the 1 year, as you have stated. So as we go forward, it will be the exact same. And I should remind you that from 2003 to 2011, our revenues expanded by 41% without us raising property taxes. My point is, if we watch our taxation levels, our taxation base will expand. Businesses will come here, people will move here. The opposite happens when we increase our taxation levels. People will leave, businesses will leave. If we increase taxation, we don't just get the money. We get a declining amount of money because we lose returns because people don't want to be here if the taxation is too high.
But you're aware that the single largest component of the rising cost is emergency services. In the last few years, it's been most of the growth in the city's operating costs. So where are you going to find the money for that?
Quickly, Gord Steeves, 20 seconds.
Well, as I mentioned in my last announcement, if we can find the 70 FTEs that we have added over the course of the last few years, we have to make a hard decision. And the hard decision is going to be that we're not going to hire anybody outside of non-essential services. That's going to save us $6 million. I also stated that if we can limit our goods and services purchases to 2%, the rate of inflation, then we are going to save potentially $35 million.
You're going to save on police and firefighters by not hiring other people who aren't police and firefighters, even though that's where the costs are going up.
And we are going to say that we are not going to buy additional goods and services as mentioned in our budget at the rate of 30 to 40%.
Okay, Mr. Steeves, I got to cut you off there. Speaking still of taxes, Judy Wasylycia-Leis, you have proposed a property tax increase. Marcy Marcusa, with questions now on your policies.
It's sort of all about math. I mean, all of us have heard economists say through this whole campaign that the math isn't adding up for all the promises. And so, infrastructure aside, and remember, we're talking about $7.4 billion aside, fixing sidewalks, buying new frozen pipe equipment, $20 million a year that's going to have to service what we have to borrow to pay for the next rapid transit line. Can you explain how we will pay for that in detail? How does your plan add up to getting us the money?
Is that a question?
Oh, Judy.
Oh, sorry.
I forgot the Judy in the beginning.
Listen, just as I said earlier to Bartley, we've got some real challenges facing us at City Hall between the infrastructure deficit and a lack of appropriate services when we get snowfalls like we did last winter and frozen pipes. So we have to have a plan that's based on an affordable tax rate. I don't agree at all with Gord. I think frozen taxes have led to crumbling roads and frozen pipes, and we got to start to actually take on this challenge with the support of Winnipeggers who are prepared to get involved as long as they know where the money is going. So my proposal is you take 2% and put it in towards the infrastructure deficit. That leads to the $400 million per year, $400 million for 4 years, and you take 1% to protect services so that we've got adequate coverage for snow clearing and better 311 response and a more effective way to at least respond to people with frozen pipes, even if the city had nothing to do with it. We still have to have a better response and at least treat this as an emergency.
you still don't have enough money. At the end of the day, you talk, you're right, the province. I'm wondering, what can you get out of the province that your challengers can't?
Well, first of all, you're right, it's not enough money, and that's why we, we're in this mess because of decades of negligence and frozen taxes. And if people want more of the same, then they should vote for this guy, Gord Steeves. But if you want better roads, if you want to fix your potholes, if you want to...
They're only laughing because they haven't heard that talking point before.
If you want better roads, then we've got to start somewhere and use our maximum tools to our maximum, get our house in order, and go to the province to then with legitimacy and credibility.
Thanks very much, Judy Wasylycia-Leis. All of you take note, this debate needs more hugs. Colin Fast with a question for David Saunders.
David, over the last few years, you've probably spent more time at City Hall than most councillors. I'm guessing you've probably spent more time going through the city books than anybody up there, with the exception of Paula, perhaps. But it was just today that you finally kind of came out with some details regarding your own tax plan for the first year in office, which I believe would be a 5% increase, which is more than anyone up there except for, I think Michelle's promised something similar. Can you give us any idea, going beyond that, what people can expect in terms of property tax increases, user fees, how much it's going to cost people?
Okay. Thanks, Colin. I have been saying for some time that a lot of the promises here didn't make much sense when we were facing what I refer to today as a Goliath of a problem with the 2015 budget. Right now, City Council will be elected in November, is going to face a projected deficit next year of $79 million and currently a projected $22 million deficit for this year, a total of $100 million. That's the problem the new council is going to face. And that's not counting rapid transit, and that's not counting major increases in infrastructure either. And what I came up with today is my best shot at how to deal with it, and that includes a realty tax increase of no more than 5%, which for an average house would be approximately $79 a year, which I think is about the maximum that the Winnipeg taxpayer would tolerate given what's happened and the fact that we have to regain the trust of the citizens. Secondly, we need to recognize that the $22 million overdraft that we're going to have this year apparently includes at least $15 million, which traditionally and habitually the city administration pads their budgets with so that they can deal with the overdraft.
All right, thanks, Mr. Saunders. We've got to stop there on this topic. Our last question on the topic of taxes coming from Marcy Marcusa to Michel Fillion.
It's actually not on taxes, so we're setting up our next section on integrity and trust.
All right.
So. I want to ask you, Michelle, what do you say to Winnipeg voters who are having trouble taking you seriously because of some of the choices and approaches you've made in terms of putting out your campaign promises on YouTube and in some cases dressing up at different forums, I think hard hat and a vest at the infrastructure forum, and even doing, I think there's an ABBA video online of you. What do you say to voters who are having trouble taking you seriously?
I think the ones that are having trouble finding this seriously are the older population, because they are traditional, let's face it. As far as the younger ones, I think they're enjoying it. But why I am doing this is not to get attention, but to get the message across. Because sometimes when you dress up like this or whatever, I mean, after a while, the people go mundane. I mean, you have to lighten them up a little bit. I mean, campaigning is very serious. And if you don't lighten things up, people don't listen to you.
But Michelle, you led tonight with talking about air raid sirens, and I think Everyone in the room kind of looked at each other like,
is that really our issue?
Are we at a presidential debate in the 50s?
It's a thought that I've been having for a long time. No, it's not a new thing, but it's never been mentioned in this campaign yet. But we have to look at that.
Why? No, really, you chose it in your opening statement.
When you have the bombs going on your head there, Marcy, I'll ask you why, okay?
I'll ask you about something else you pitched. You pitched cleanup days in Winnipeg, where residents would take on more civic responsibility for literally cleaning the streets.
Yeah, Broom Sunday, yes.
Broom Sundays. Are we looking for too much from city services? Why should residents pick up brooms?
Well, first thing is to lessen the cost of cleaning up in the springtime. I mean, go around town and you look. Take a deep look if the city is clean, and it's not. We do not have the machinery to do that, and we do not have the manpower to do that. is fairly expensive, and that's why I'm asking the citizens to participate. It would be, like I said, one day during the year, and it involves community involvement. And that's not a bad thing there, Marcy.
All right, thanks a lot, Mr. Fillion. We're on the topic of, well, it's what every politician says they have, but none says they can find at City Hall. It's integrity is our topic. And we'll go to Martin Kivas to ask Paula Havixbeck a question.
Councillor Havixbeck, you've repeatedly reminded everybody during this campaign that you were the person who held former Chief Administrative Officer Phil Schiegel to account, grilled him on the floor of council. Why didn't you remain in that watchdog role instead of fighting this low percentage battle for mayor?
That's a great question, and I want to thank you for that. And I want to thank you for the work that you, all media, do in trying to expose the truth, because City Hall has had a number of fiascos. And I think that it demonstrates integrity when you can go in a room with your colleagues and stand up and say, we will not have this mismanagement anymore, and we will not have tax increases to pay for that mismanagement. You know, I've heard a lot of things up and down the table here, and I'd like to correct a number of things. But the biggest thing that I could say is that we saw $100 million of cost overruns on projects. Why should the citizens in this city have to pay for it? And so to go back to your question, which you started with, is I think that that shows integrity, number one, and I have demonstrated it.
Why?
And that is the kind of mayor I would be in this city. I'm not beholden to anybody. I owe no claims to developers, to big business, or to unions. And I think citizens want a mayor that is not beholden to anybody. That's what's gotten us here.
All right, thanks very much, Ms. Havixbeck. We're going to call in Fast now with a question on integrity for Gord Steeves.
Gord, the origin of this whole integrity, accountability, transparency issue really comes down to three things. It's fire halls, it's police headquarters, and it's Phil Schiegel. You were on EPC when all those decisions were made. Is there anything that, you know, looking back now, you wish that you had done differently?
Well, I wasn't, the fire hall issue, I think it was really in a very, very nascent spot when I left council 3.5 years ago. With respect to the police headquarters, I thought putting the police headquarters at the Canada Post building was a good idea. Still think that today. My last meeting on council in July of 2011, we sent a report to council and we said there's problems with the pricing on this matter. There's going to be some issues with costing on this. That was my last meeting. We put it squarely in front of council, warned, and I left at that point. I resigned from council. 1 year later, a report came back saying everything is fine. 2 years later, a report came back that said, okay, we now have another problem. So by the time the cost overruns were recognized with the police headquarters, I'd been gone 2 years. If I want to be held to account for making the decision to put the police in the headquarters in the Canada Post building, that's fine. I made that decision. I still think it's a good decision. But I was not around for, there wasn't a nail hammered or there wasn't a piece of drywall taken off the wall when I left City Council.
So no regrets about your involvement in any of those things. What about the hiring of Phil Schiegel?
Well, that decision obviously didn't work out perfectly, but but I think we can, you know, but again, my belief is that over the course of the last, I've been gone 3.5-ish years, and I think a lot of the problems that have arisen in City Hall have happened during that time. The impression I had when I left City Council was that, yeah, it was going to a place that maybe wasn't perfect, but it seemed to me at the time that people were getting along reasonably well, and council was working not perfectly, but decently at the time. It did seem to me, and I don't take any credit or joy in saying this, but when I left City Council, my impression was that maybe things started to disassemble a little bit, and they went to a place that was maybe a little less structured. And I don't know if people agree with me or not, but I like to think that when I was at council, I offered a bit of that stabilizing influence to people. I would invite anybody to talk to Glenn Murray, Mayor Sam Cates, any of the counselors that I ever worked with. I think each and every one of them would tell you that I was a good guy to work with, honest, had integrity, and you could trust me.
Mr. Ouellette, you laughed a minute ago there. What's your response to what Mr. Steeves said?
That's a very interesting question. Well, I think just throughout this campaign, I've demonstrated the above average integrity and openness about how we actually go about financing campaigns. Because I think
you're one of the political newcomers. How could you go into that kind of environment that Mr. Steeves described and make any changes?
Well, I think we need to have more openness in the way we actually finance campaigns and demonstrate to all people that actually, right from the get-go, if we believe in openness and transparency, that we lead by example and we disclose who's donating to our campaign, but also the amounts of money that people are donating to us. And that also that we send and spend time actually compiling a list of contractors who are working for the city who have donated to political campaigns to make it more open and transparent about the power structures that exist within City Hall to ensure that they don't go overboard and they start taking undue profit from the city.
All right, thanks, Mr. Ouellette. Our last question for now on the topic of integrity for our media panel comes from Bartley Kivas to Brian Bowman.
Okay, Brian, you're a privacy lawyer. You've been Mr. Open Data, Open Government during this campaign. But how would you ensure that all of the issues that Colin brought up, real estate, fire paramedic station, police headquarters, everything, how would you ensure all these things are fully investigated if you were elected as mayor? And how would you hold individuals accountable? And how would you ensure this never happened again? And don't say by putting things online.
Well, if you're asking me how do you clean up the mess that was created by the politicians that have been there, you're right, there's going to be a lot of work that has to happen, and I'm prepared to do that. I'll do what I've done when I've been in a position of leadership for other organizations, for the Winnipeg Chamber of Commerce, the Winnipeg Art Gallery. I'll lead by example. I'll hold people to account. And you're right, I will shine a light in the corridors of power
but
by having greater openness.
Specifically, what would you do? Because you haven't dealt a lot specifically with Mr. Sanders and Ms. Havixbeck have spoken a lot about the specifics on those areas. What specifically would you do?
Well, I'm not planning to have those types of scandals on my watch. That's going to be the biggest difference between my watch and the watch that we've seen.
It's not over yet, though. We still have
You're right, and the matter is now before the RCMP, and as a lawyer, I do understand that there's due process that has to happen. And so I'll be wanting to see what happens with the RCMP's work. But make no mistake about it, the first decision that I'll have to make if given the opportunity to serve will be to select a new CAO. And that's going to be one of the most important decisions that the next mayor makes. And getting that right and having the ability to actually serve in a leadership role in the past in numerous instances does set me apart from the main challengers.
So are you going to be walking to City Hall with an axe?
You know what? I'm going to do whatever it takes to restore trust and accountability at City Hall. I'm one who's been watching what's been going on from the outside, like many Winnipeggers out there, and I haven't been well served, neither have you. And so that's why I want to get in there, because I want to clean things up. My first announcement was on a robust openness and transparency initiative so that we never have to be talking about these types of audits again. If you want more of the same, go with a politician who's been around for decades. Go for somebody who's been there, who's part of the problem. I offer something that's positive, that's new, and hopefully prevents these types of situations from happening in the first place.
We need a talking point buzzer when you guys go back to those, just like
maybe an
electric
shock.
Thought
we drink, then.
Yeah.
All right, that wraps up our first round. Now, as promised, you're able to send in questions via Twitter, and we have a couple of questions standing by sent to us on Twitter. I'll take a look at the first one here. Justin Tropia asks, I would ask all mayoral candidates, what is their stance on the photo radar program? I know we've had quite a few policy announcements on that one. I'd like to start with Paula Havixbeck. What would you do with photo radar? Would you change anything or leave it as it is?
I would absolutely change some things on that. I've had an announcement on that in my campaign, and what I've said is that I'm finding that the vehicular mobile photo radar is ineffective. Often the vehicles are improperly parked. I would be looking to cancel that portion of the contract, but I would be looking also. We have 50 stationary cameras around the city, and only 36 of them are operative. I'd be looking to enhance that, as well as what police officers are doing, because many times there are other crimes being committed that police officers, when they stop a driver, can catch them on the speeding, plus being on a cell phone or whatever else the violations are. So that's my stance on
this. This is sort of a hot button topic, media panel. I mean, everybody has an opinion on photo radar. What do you think has been the position from any of the candidates that you think is going to grab the most public attention, for right or for wrong?
Well, former Councillor Steeves has been standing by the side of the road to try to grab public attention for pretty much of that.
The show business part.
I gotta ask. I mean, Councillor Steeves, you have repeatedly gone back to this, three times, if not four. Is this going to win you this thing, voter rater?
Well, I don't know about that, but well, it's... Photo radar was introduced, I was on council when it was introduced. We started off with red light cameras. I think it's evolved to a place where, regrettably, photo radar is now less about safety and more about obtaining revenue for both the province and the city. I think it has a lot to do with the debt position of the province of Manitoba. The province is $31 billion in debt and they're driving these decisions. I don't mind telling you that I think we, as a city, are deliberately profiting from areas that are poorly signed. I actually will say that in construction zones, we're giving out tickets when there's no workers present, and the amount of tickets are absolutely punitive. They're way too high. Now, I acknowledge that we need some type of disincentive for people, but I just, there's a limit. And I think to give a university student an $800 ticket going through a construction zone where there's no workers present for going 63 in a 50 is punitive. And we have to watch ourselves as government because we don't want to get to a place where people are losing confidence in the program that is designed to protect them. And there's no doubt in my mind, if the moderator is telling us he's getting a lot of questions on photo radar, that people have lost confidence in this program and they now think it's less about safety and it's more about finding revenue, and that's wrong.
Mr. Bowman wants to jump in on that question.
Well, I have a very different approach. I don't think this is show business. I think this is about public service, and the public service is made when we protect the safety of families and children. My wife, Tracy, and I have two young boys, and I can tell you, I think Gord Steeves did a great disservice by trying to grandstand during a campaign to try to somehow help people who may be breaking the law. Try not to speed and you won't get a ticket. Secondly, when there are tickets issued and photo radar in particular, especially through construction zones, let's have better signage so people know when the rules are changing for the road. We have to be honest and act with integrity towards drivers, but safety is number one for me, and the safety of children on our streets.
Okay, this isn't in the script, but I see a lot of interest in this. Let's go quickly. It's 20 seconds for each for the rest of you. Mr. Ouellette on photo radar.
Well, I think we actually need to think about actually studying the issue more appropriately and actually have an independent body such as the police board actually investigate this to understand if it's really about safety or if it's about revenue generation. And if it's not about safety, then we should get rid of the cameras. But if it is about safety and they do serve a purpose, then they should tell us the most appropriate way of actually going forward with that. And so this is my approach in actually just using good city planning to ensure that we're doing something appropriately.
Mr. Saunders on photo radar.
It should be intended to be for safety. It's not supposed to be for revenue, although that unfortunately is the pressure on the police department. I have endorsed the recommendations of the Wise Up Winnipeg group and the research they've done, which show that the major problems with signage, which is misleading to the public, and the fact that rather than fix the signs and fix the roads, they're simply using it as a means to collect more fares.
Mr. Fillion?
I would keep photo radar as is. I do not believe it's for revenue. I do believe it is for safety, like everyone else says. And in fact, I would probably want to expand on it on a different direction with the light standards or know the lights. So that I would have to discuss that with the Department of Engineering.
Paula Havixbeck, did you want to jump in on this too?
I think I've said where I stand on that and that I would eliminate the mobile photo radar and add more cameras where there are the permanent stations located because they're not all filled, they rotate them. And I would also have more police officers be doing photo safety and photo enforcement.
And Judy Wasylycia-Leis.
I've had three photo radar tickets in this campaign and I deserved every one of them.
Yes, you did. Yes, I do. You covered a lot of ground.
I appreciate...
Points for transparency.
I appreciate the system.
Here's the problem.
But, so it's there for a good reason. I was going too fast, and so it is about safety. And if there are any changes that people feel should be made to the system, I would do in consultation with the police force, the chief of police, and of course, the new city council.
All right, you heard it here first. Let's take one more question from Twitter. Dakota Kachi asks, he's directing this to Brian Bowman, with youth being generally disinterested in politics, what will you do to re-engage them?
That's a great question, and thank you very much for that. There's a number of things that we can do to better engage youth. First is, let's get a new generation of political leadership at City Hall that has a different, more forward-looking approach. We've seen that approach taken in other cities. Dawn Iveson's a new mayor of Edmonton. And when I talk about new generation leadership, I'm talking about forward-looking, visionary, pragmatic, and a lot more technology savvy. In terms of specific announceables, the Open Data Initiative and Open Government initiatives that I've proposed are intended to create greater openness and transparency to pull all people in, especially our younger entrepreneurs in our community. I've also committed that within the first 3 years of my term as mayor, if elected, I want to visit every high school in Winnipeg in order to talk about public service. I don't want to do it in the last year because hopefully I'll be running for re-election, and I don't want politics to get in the way of engaging our youth. There's a lot more that we can do to engage youth, including working on our community centers and many other announcements that I've made. But this is a challenge for all elected officials. It's something that, quite frankly, we haven't done as good a job as we can, and that's why I'm running.
One of the scariest points in this campaign came for me when I was speaking to a group of students at the University of Manitoba, 40 Winnipeg students who were graduating from political science, and I asked all 40 of them, of the 40 of you, how many of you expect to be here in 10 years? And five of them put up their hand. And I asked why, and they said opportunity and cost. They see our city as being too expensive to live in without the necessary economic opportunity. We are losing so many of our young people to other cities, Calgary, Edmonton, Saskatoon, Regina now. It is incumbent upon us to make sure that young people who are coming up who want to buy homes aren't facing unreasonable and exorbitant tax burdens, because that is what's driving them away. Of course, when they leave, they're not going to be very involved in our political process.
All right, thanks a lot, Gord Steeves. We've got one more question on Twitter. Do we have one more question on Twitter? All right. Let's talk about downtown. What are the plans for improvement of the downtown? This question coming from Happy Randy. So let's see who can keep Randy happy on the question of downtown. What are your plans for improvement of downtown? Mitch Fillion, you've had a few things to say about that during the campaign.
To improve downtown, well, the major thing for, I was talking about this in an interview yesterday, is to fix the roads. I mean, when Portage and Main are our pride and joy, and take a look at them downtown. I mean, some people don't never go there, but they are atrocious. When we have tourist buses arriving at the MTS Center and they get off the bus, and they look at our roads, we're embarrassed. So that's the number one thing I would attack on. Number two is to have a grocery store. Realize that it's not only poor people that live downtown. We have middle class people and we have wealthy people. But the thing is, we are all in the same boat. We do not have a grocery store. Therefore, if you don't have a vehicle, you're subject to go to convenience stores, which for the poor people, I mean, it's fairly expensive. They cannot afford it. And third of all would be basically to beautify it. For example, the exchange districts, would to make it more viable for residency.
All right, thanks so much, Mr. Fillion. Thanks a lot for you who sent questions in on Twitter. We'll do more later on in the debate. We've got to take a short break now for 5 minutes. We'll be back with the Street Around, when we took to the streets to ask you to come up with questions for our candidates. Also, you can join the conversation online via Twitter at ShawTVWinnipeg. Pose a question to the candidates using the hashtag YourMayor. We'll be back. Stay with us. Welcome back to Your Mayor Live on Shaw TV, live streamed on globalnews.ca/Winnipeg. This is the only live televised debate in the mayoral race in Winnipeg's civic election for 2014. So if you're just tuning in, we've had one round of questions from our media panel on infrastructure, on taxes, and on integrity. We've learned that Judy Wasylycia-Leis has had 3 photo radar tickets. We'll also hear later on in the show the candidates go head-to-head with each other, challenging each other with direct questions. For now, we've gone to the streets to get some questions from you, the public. So let's take a look at our first question here, which will be directed to Paula Havixbeck.
I need to know how you're going to be able to engage young people in Winnipeg to be able to stay in Winnipeg and be productive in Winnipeg and not leave our province.
There was a similar question directed to Brian Bowman from Twitter, but Paul Havixbeck, what would you do to keep young people in Winnipeg?
That's a great question, and you know, I have taught at a university level, and I ask students in the first day of class, what do you hope to accomplish? And unfortunately, at least one in four plan to leave our city. They're not engaged. They don't want to be here. They want to leave as quickly as they can. And so I ask why. And young people tell me that they want clean, reliable, safe public transportation to use to get to and from where they're going, and they want more vibrancy in our downtown. And right now, downtown is so-so. What I would do to improve downtown is get more people living there, get more people being there and adding to that vibrancy. The Jets have added a lot to our downtown, but that's temporary. People come and go for an evening. Having people live there, we have tremendous barriers in the kinds of stores we can get. And when you look at Portage and Main, the first three blocks are vacant. And we need to try to restore having and encourage business to want to be downtown. So I would be looking at different kinds of incentives to try to get business to want to be downtown and create meaningful jobs as well. Young people graduating want to have meaningful work, and they're disengaged when they don't see any of us having anything to offer in that realm.
Okay, thanks, Ms. Havixbeck. Now, you mentioned downtown. This came up before. Gord Steeves, what would you do to improve the downtown?
The downtown represents one of the biggest challenges that we have.
Do you think safety is a problem in particular?
I do absolutely think safety is a problem, and it's not just my opinion. It's actually something that we survey each and every year at the City of Winnipeg.
Like Marcy, you've got a question.
I just because it came up today, earlier today I heard you say that 0% of women feel safe downtown. And I want to know where you get that from as a woman in Winnipeg.
Oh, we survey every year. The City of Winnipeg does, when I say we. Over the course of the last 5 years, the range of people who have said they feel safe downtown overall falls somewhere between 12% and 38%, and 38% was an anomaly. Zero was perhaps an exaggeration, but 18% of people total means that most of the 18% are men. And there are a large percentage of women that do not feel safe downtown. And now, we might not like to hear that, but of course, the first step to remedying the problem is to acknowledge that it exists. My opinion and my theory on securing our downtown again is exactly this. We need to establish a presence downtown. And I've proposed in this campaign to present 20 cadets, along with all of the other support, police, foot patrol, and everything else that exists in our downtown, to be established downtown, to hold our downtown and to establish a presence so that we can hold that presence and ensure that anybody in our downtown who is not acting appropriately is going to be removed. If they're inebriated, if they're accosting people, aggressively panhandling.
I don't want to be sadistic, but I really want to know what Mr. Ouellette thinks of your plan.
Okay.
Robert-Falcon,
well, I actually think there's actually a different approach we can take in the City of Winnipeg. In fact, actually, I believe in something called the land value tax. Taxing those surface parking lots in the downtown core in order to spur developers and land developers to actually start building things, building buildings, more commercial space, more residential space.
I don't think that's what Robert Keefus was getting at, though, Robert-Falcon.
I know it's easy for us to actually say we need to build a fortress Winnipeg, but it's harder for us to build a community. And for me, the idea, if we actually want to have a united city, we need to be rubbing shoulders together, but we need places for people to live, and people for businesses. And businesses will only be successful, we can reduce the taxes for businesses all we like, but if they don't have customers, they're not going to thrive. And so we need to get more people living downtown. And to do that, we need to spur the developers to actually go ahead and push them to do that. We have all these surface parking lots in our downtown core, and it's like teeth have been knocked out of someone's mouth. And it's frankly, it creates dead zones. It's terrible for city planning. It's terrible for urbanism. It creates a feeling of unsafety or unsafeness when you're walking around there. And so if we really want to be developing our downtown, it's going to have to start with those service parking lots.
Okay, I'll go to our next clip now from the people we spoke to on the streets. This one directed to David Saunders.
As Winnipeg approaches a million people, we really need to look strategically at what our infrastructure will look like and how we're going to accommodate that. This is a city that has a lot of promise, but a mayoral candidate really has to be looking at that 1 million number in terms of population and address and have the vision as to how we're going to get there.
David Saunders, getting the city to a million people, how to do that?
Well, that's another 300,000. That's a lot of people, and that is the projection. But getting there is something else again. Frankly, I don't expect this to be a million people shortly. I think we need to ensure that we keep the ones we have here, we support them and their businesses that are already here, the young people who wish to stay here, and at the same time support those who wish to go out forth in the world and do great things, because many do, and we're proud of that. As far as the infrastructure goes, we need to have our long-range plans, which we have had for a long period of time, for water, for sewer, for public transit, for roadways, and need to work steadily to improve them, rehabilitate them, and extend them, but extend them at a rate which we can afford, and that means we should not be allowing for the urban sprawl that we've seen both on the boundaries of City Winnipeg and indeed outside of the boundaries of City Winnipeg.
All right, thanks so much, Mr. Saunders. You are watching Your Mayor live on Shaw TV, also live streamed on globalnews.ca/Winnipeg. We're taking questions from the streets. Our cameras went out to ask people what questions they wanted to ask the candidates. This next one is directed to Gord Steeves.
What are you going to do about the missing Aboriginal girls?
Yeah, that's a quick one. It's obviously been a quite a big topic, an emotional topic, the topic of missing and murdered Aboriginal women and girls. Gord Steeves, what are your thoughts on how the city in particular could move forward, could make changes in that area?
Well, our most direct link to any sort of violence in our community is obviously through our police department. There's no doubt about that. I don't know that there would necessarily be anything specific other than having our police department, which they have said repeatedly that are going to cooperate fully with any national or provincial investigation, and they're going to offer up their services to be that on the ground support to ensuring that they are doing everything in their power. My opinion again is that if we to attack this problem long term, the issue of violence in our community, particularly with any particular group, has more to do with poverty than anything else, and economic opportunity. What people need is the ability to succeed in our community, and I don't know that there's any greater remedy than having a system that allows people to succeed, and my theory has always been that if we can keep costs down and make sure that people have the ability to raise their families and have the ability to stay out of poverty, and government can do its part by not putting an onerous financial burden on those families, that is the best thing we can do to help.
Yeah, Brian Bowman, you want to jump into that question? The original question was on how to respond to the issue of missing and murdered Aboriginal women and girls.
Well, I think what Gord Steeves should have said just now is, I'm sorry that I've treated members of our Aboriginal community during this campaign with such disrespect. And if you want to serve all Winnipeggers, we need to treat all Winnipeggers, including members of our Indigenous community, with respect. Skipping forums is one way during the campaign that you can show respect to so many members of our community who are reaching out to all of us as candidates. In terms of missing and murdered Aboriginal women, we need to do a better job. Yes, law enforcement has a role to play, but the underlying causes of some of the sociological issues that we're having in our country and in Winnipeg need to be dealt with, and then we need to start showing a little compassion and actually doing what they're looking for from our elected officials. And missing forum after forum is not sending the right signal.
Mr. Steeves, do you think that's fair? Like, that's a fair comment on that.
I don't believe that's fair, but I don't care if it's fair or not. Mr. Bowman can have his opinion. I have, throughout the course of my tenure at City Hall, I don't think anyone has ever asserted that I was ever disrespectful to anybody. First Nations group, I have a track record. I have 11 years of experience on council. I would invite anybody to speak with anybody that I work with, anybody that I served with over the course of those 11 years. And I would challenge you to find a single person to say that I was in any way disrespectful to anybody as I served on council.
All right, we're going to go to our next question from Twitter. You can tweet these to us at Shaw TV Winnipeg, hashtag Your Mayor. This one coming from Dan Penner, talking about infrastructure issues. He says, they're a result of poor growth management. How would candidates promote compact city building? Let's start with Paula Havixbeck on that one.
You know, it's been my observation that we have gone in an interesting cycle. We have expanded and spiraled out of our city to the extremities, and all the while have not created as walkable of communities. So that is having all of the amenities and things that are nearby so that you can walk. We have built suburbs without having these amenities in mind. And only in more recent years, I would say, is there an actual deliberate effort and work being done towards having active transportation systems, having grocery stores right in a community so that people don't need to get right into their cars. The reality is that the city is growing out of a land supply. There's about a 7-year land supply left for the city of Winnipeg. And so there is no alternative but to go up instead of out. And so in coming up with more compact neighborhoods, we need to get our heads around having higher density, that being multifamily units, going higher with our buildings, and looking at ways that we can do that and all live together with it.
All right, thanks very much, Paula. We are going to take a short break now. When we come back, the candidates go head-to-head and around and they challenge each other with questions. You're watching Your Mayor on Shaw TV. We'll be right back. First and only live televised debate. All the candidates involved on race for mayor in the 2014 civic election. We've had a pretty great debate already tonight. Two rounds of questions, starting off with our media panel, then questions from the public, both on tape and on Twitter. And now we're going to go to the candidate-to-candidate round. This is where each candidate gets to pick another candidate to ask a question and challenge them with questions. We've already seen some of that, in fact. Up to this point, our media panel can jump in as well. 30 seconds to ask your questions, folks, and 60 seconds to respond. We'll start with Michel Fillion. Michel, would you like to ask a question?
I want to ask a question to Brian. He's been very adamant about having a dog park downtown, as if it's like no priority. But where do you plan to have this? I live downtown and I can't see it.
Well, it won't be, thanks for the question. The reason why I support the creation of an off-leash dog park downtown is I want to make downtown a lot more livable. I want a lot more people living downtown. And my campaign pledge is to raise the number of residents from downtown from currently around 15,000 to 20,000. The off-leash dog park, ideally I'd like to see it in the Stephen Juba Park, but I'd be open to working with the Forks North Portage Partnership to find the best site location for it. But look, there's a lot of people who work downtown, they live downtown, and they have pets, and I want to make it a lot more livable community for all.
Are you going to add 5,000 more people or dogs?
Well, I don't expect below 5,000 more dogs, but look, I'm a dog lover, and so the more dogs, the better. I also want to see a downtown community center in the Parcel 4 lands, and there's a lot more we can do. I don't see downtown as one of our greatest challenges. I think it's one of our greatest opportunities.
All right, thanks, Mr. Bowman. Thanks, Mr. Fillion. A candidate-to-candidate round here in our debate. We're going now to Robert-Falcon Ouellette. He has the option now to pick any other candidate he wants to and ask any question he wants.
Thank you. I would ask Judy a question related to BRT. I think it's, for myself, when I think about it, it's terrible for the environmental impact of pouring more concrete. The first phase was not very successful. In fact, there's already cracks along that infrastructure. And we have to rebuild the Arlington Bridge and another underpass at Waverly and Taylor. Wouldn't it be better to think along long-term and consider actual rail relocation for both the safety impact, but also the environmental and positive economic impact that we could have for even putting in place light rail transit in the city of Winnipeg?
Thanks for the question, Robert. BRT is a big issue in this campaign because we're faced with a half-built transitway left as a legacy to all of us to figure out what to do with from the last council. And years of dithering from Sam Cates and other council members has caused this problem. And I, for one, will not leave an unfinished transitway. We got to finish it. And I think we have a way to do that through reducing some of the costs and also through tax increment financing vis-a-vis new housing development. But the bigger issue here is a vision for Winnipeg. And I agree with Robert. We need to dream big. We all want to see rapid transit in a city this size. It's a disgrace that we don't have it. But how do we get there is the question. And I think given the fact that we've got a $7.4 billion infrastructure deficit, we're going to have to tackle one problem at a time on a practical basis. So my plan is to focus on potholes and frozen pipes and water mains and wastewater systems, but also to finish this one leg of bus rapid transit, and then plan with the community in a proper way, with proper financing, how to go forward with the other three lines that are already on the drawing board and being planned as we speak. The line out to Transcona is in the works. We need to get on top of this plan and start to do it in a way that Winnipeggers feel good about and that is financially responsible.
So this could indeed be the election that decides the future of transit in Winnipeg, with so many different points of view on how to proceed or not proceed with bus rapid transit. Robert-Falcon, why don't you pose that question to start with, and Jim, a follow-up.
Well, it just seems to me that if we continue along with the mistake that was made by a previous administration, we shouldn't continue trying to make another mistake in the second phase. And that money that's going to be spent on BRT, $225 million on the part of the province, or on the part of the city as well, could be better used, combining with the savings from the Arlington Bridge and the underpass in Waverly at $50 million, combined to actually start getting that process more forward in rail relocation, doing the study and doing what we need to be doing for that long-term vision for a city of a million people. Because if we do have a million people, we need to get people, goods, and services around the city in an efficient way. And I don't think we've adequately understood where people live, where they want to go, and who actually uses public transportation, not just BRT, you know, let's not use Orwellian terms of rapid transit, but public transportation. And that's third, that leg down in the south end of the city, it doesn't benefit all citizens and the people who need it most. And this is my greatest concern about this. We're spending money and wasting money, and it's not benefiting all citizens.
This really has been one of the and there's different views on how to proceed with bus rapid transit or the future for transit. All in all in the city. Colin Fast on our media panel from the Metro Winnipeg, a question on that.
Yeah, Judy, just to follow up, I know that you've mentioned several times the importance of, you know, we have to finish this, we can't have the embarrassment of a half-finished line. Beyond simply saying, look, we finished it, what's the measure of success going to be for that line? What's going to happen that we'll be able to point to and say it's been a success? Because I think, as Marcy pointed out previously, the half line that we have there, the portion of the
then
line
we have two half lines,
you know, is you know, hasn't really done what it was promised.
Well, just taking that half of the line, you can actually enjoy and feel the benefits of bus rapid transit. It's a wonderful experience. It's just over in a second, a nanosecond, and it's time actually to complete it and to then you will see, I know this, I mean, the students going back and forth between the universities and the people caught up in those traffic jams and the potential for housing development and to pursue the dreams of densification are so wrapped up in this project. To stop it now would be, in fact, to waste the, how much did we spend on the first 3.6 kilometers?
$138 million.
Right. So, I mean, I think it's a pretty cost-effective and fiscally responsible way to go. Finish what you started. It's going to work. I know I've been on a bus rapid transit system. I've lived in Ottawa. I know that it can work. And it's something we can afford. And heck, on top of that, we're actually a manufacturer here of buses. We have Flyer making buses that, electric buses and environmentally efficient buses that other cities are buying, and we're not necessarily looking at our own marketplace. We could be improving our transit system, creating jobs, and reducing our carbon footprint.
So you're guaranteeing that if it gets finished, that we're going to see all sorts of, you know, intense development along that line?
We'll see development, and heck, we're going to see a lot of people using it, going back and forth to the stadium, going back and forth to university and home, going back and forth to shop downtown. It's going to be actually, it's going to make a difference, and what it will do is give Winnipeggers a taste of what rapid transit actually can be like and how important it is for the future. And we also know that if some new development, some new idea comes along that is better than BRT, you can convert this line to LRT or whatever else it makes sense in the future. But for goodness sakes, let's get the job done and deal with this traffic congestion that Listen, everybody feels on a daily basis going on Pembina Highway. Just this morning, the news reports were full of problems and backup and congestion. It's time we get on with traffic flow that makes sense and with a plan that is based on a modern metropolitan city.
All right, thanks, Ms. Walsh. Ms. Lee, we are candidate round in the Your Mayor debate here on Shaw TV. We're live streamed on globalnews.ca/Winnipeg. It's the election campaign's only live televised debate, an hour in the round where the candidates ask each other questions. We had put a debate sparked by Mr. Ouellette's question about rapid transit to Judy Wasylycia-Leis. Now it's Brian Bowman's turn to ask a question. Who's your target, Brian?
Sure, I've got a question for Judy. And this question is about leadership. Many Winnipeggers, I think myself included, have been disappointed by what we've seen from Judy during the course of this campaign. After 3 decades of being a politician, and really campaigning nonstop for this position that she's coveted for so long for the last 4 years. I think a lot of us expected to see more policies and a real vision presented. My vision is clear. I want to build a city for 1 million people, and I've had very comprehensive, detailed plans in order to do that. In many ways, Judy, you've been campaigning like you've already won. And now your radio ads are saying that this is not an entry-level job. I agree, it's not an entry-level job, which is why I'm proud to come to the position having led the Winnipeg Chamber of Commerce, the Winnipeg Art Gallery, and the U of M Alumni Association. My question for you is, what organizations have you led?
It begs for a rhetorical question, which is, Brian, if you're so critical about politicians, why are you running for this job? The
question is, well, let me further answer this question. What organizations have you led?
That in fact, politics is a noble calling, and it is about public service, and we do need someone with experience at City Hall who understands how government works, who knows about budgeting, who knows about public accounts, and has been learning and developing and initiating new governance models here at home and internationally. I've just spent time overseas working with the National Democratic Institute, teaching democracy and capacity building in countries like Jordan and Pakistan and Kosovo. I have a wealth of experience that I think can be put to good use in the city. I also want to tell you, Brian, the challenges we're facing at the city on October the 23rd are enormous. And we need someone who's ready to go in and put a team together and implement Accountability Winnipeg as soon as possible so that people can feel trust again in their own city council.
And the question was about, I think it focuses in.
I just asked what organizations has she led. She's running radio ads right now saying this isn't an entry level job, and I'm asking
how about being a cabinet minister in a government? How about being a finance critic? How about being a public accounts spokesperson? How about being a mother? How about being a volunteer? How about being an international democracy builder? How about being someone who cares about her community? How about being someone who has devoted years of her life to serve other people and is willing to take another great challenge to try to fix the city and make a city that works?
Mr. Bowman.
Throughout the campaign, that your decades and decades of service is something to be respected, and I do thank you for your years of public service. But when you make the issue during the campaign that this isn't an entry-level job and that you need leadership experience, which is something she's been saying in the debates, I just wanted to know which organizations have you led, because it's different when you're a critic. It's different when you're sitting in the opposition benches. Those are still worthwhile, noble causes for which you were elected, and I applaud you for it. But leading is different, and we've seen a lack of leadership at City Hall, and that's what we need more of. And that's what I have thought.
Over the last 10 years, we had someone in office who said it was good for him to be there because he had no political experience. Look where that got us.
Well, what do you need, though? I mean,
we're now candidate to candidate round. We're going to carry on now with David Saunders. Who would you pick on to ask a question, Mr. Saunders?
Well, given the discussion, I think I have a question for Brian Bowman. We've talked about the business community and leadership. And I think I'd like to point out that the city of Winnipeg is a very large operation with an annual operating budget of $1 billion, not a billion and a half, $1 billion, and with a capital budget of close to $600 million. This is a very large operation, 9,000 employees. And we're facing a serious budget problem right away of $100 million. And so I have to ask Brian, if he were mayor, what would he recommend that the new city council do to deal with that $100 million problem this fall?
Well, thank you very much for the question. The first thing that we need to do is we need to hire the right CAO. What I would do to answer your question, though, is do what I've done with other positions in which I've led. Make sure you get the right people there. Make sure you work to balance the books, which I've done numerous times. I'm proud to have said that under my watch, the Winnipeg Art Gallery had record surpluses. I'm proud to say the Winnipeg Chamber of Commerce had surpluses, increased memberships, and I led competent teams that got the job done. And that's what I'll do, given the job, beginning October 23rd.
Candidate round is focused on the last couple on.
Do I get to respond to that?
Oh, absolutely, Mr. Saunders. Redirect.
So you don't have an answer to my question as to how you find $100 million?
Well, I've been talking about where, if you're asking where are we going to be getting money, I've been talking about efficiencies. Judy's been attacking me for coming up with efficiencies during the campaign. I mean, one of my earlier announcements was finding 2% efficiencies. 2% efficiencies, that's in each department, excluding first responders, is $40 million over the course of the term. I've also been talking about the fair share for Winnipeg. I'm the only one that's talking about that, David, and we haven't heard Judy say that she's willing to take on the provincial NDP and actually fight for a fair share. That's $100 million if we were to get it, 104. As the economy grows, that number is gonna increase. That's a big deal for Winnipeg. And I'm prepared to fight for that in the next provincial election. Regardless of who's in there, I'm going to be pushing all the provincial parties to make sure that they give us our fair share. Over $1 billion over the next 10 years. That is not chump change. That is a lot of money that we need to get right here in Winnipeg. I've also talked about increasing the business community by giving tax breaks to the small businesses. That's something Judy wants to pull more revenues when it comes to the business community. I want to decrease the burden on those companies that need the help most so that we can increase the economic activity here, which is going to create a lot more money for the taxpayers.
Mr. Bowman, I don't want to stray too far from our format, but you brought up a question that I think Ms. Wasylycia-Leis wanted to respond to, and it's been a question on some minds in the media in the past, is your connection with the New Democratic Party federally and provincially and how that could influence you in your role as mayor. Would you be able to quote-unquote stand up to the provincial government to get what Winnipeg needs?
My party background is well known. I'm a proud New Democrat, and I'm not about to change my spots just because it's convenient for in this race. And I think people respect the fact that I have been serving in public office, representing a party, but working with other political parties and advancing the issues of our community, especially Winnipeg's North End. I think, we all bring to the table different political connections. I don't think you can find a campaign among us where there isn't someone with a political party connection, someone working on a campaign from a certain political party. We all bring that to the table. We're all active people. We're all serving the public. If you don't have that kind of identity, it means you haven't really taken an interest and played a part in politics. We've all done it, and I think it's time to respect differences and know what we bring to the table. And finally, I would say, I've never been shy about speaking up and taking on the provincial government or the federal government or any government when an injustice is being done and when there's a need in our community. And you can bet your bottom dollar I'll be standing up to the provincial government and the federal government and demanding our fair share and a new deal for cities.
We're going to take some questions from Twitter in a moment. Of party affiliations and political connections. We've got some of the most experienced political watchers in the city on our media panel. Bartley Kivas, how do you think that dynamic will play into voters' minds if it's Judy Wasylycia-Leis's connections to the New Democratic Party or Brian Bowman's connections to the Chamber of Commerce?
I don't know how it's going to play in the voters' minds, but voters have to be strategic in the wards that they're in right now, because we have a number of wards that are going to change hands, and the traditional center-right majority that we've seen in the last two terms might be losing things. So actually, I got to turn things around into a question to everybody but Judy. I'll make this question to Gord or to Brian or to both. How would you gentlemen deal with a center-left coalition that could emerge, or a 9-vote center-left majority on council, and get things done without quite literally having Sam Cates' 2010 fear of the NDP taking over City Hall come to fruition?
Gord Steeves, go ahead.
You bet. Yeah, this is one of the interesting things about this race, is that whoever's elected mayor, there's another hand to be dealt, and it is the council. And no one here knows what the council's will is going to be, because you're only one vote. That is where I think experience is going to pay the biggest dividends. There is only one way to build consensus on council, and that is through working with people and establishing consensus to get ideas through. If in 2001 you would have said, do you think this council can pass 11 successive budgets, all of which are going to freeze property taxes, would you have thought that was possible? Well, it was. And it was done through talking with people, building consensus, sort of bringing people along to establish a point of view that, you know, we actually are, regardless of stripe, NDP, Liberal, Conservative, we were doing some things wrong. We were taxing people too highly, and it was causing problems in our community. There is no silver bullet. It is simply a matter of spending the hours and days and using all of your experience, all of your wherewithal, to do as I did for 11 years.
So how you deal with left of center councillors is what?
Well, you have to work with them. There's no other way to do it, is you have to work with all of your council colleagues. And you have to impress upon them, and they have to impress upon you, how they feel, and you have to work through your differences and arrive at a consensus.
Thanks, Gord Steeves. I think Robert-Falcon wanted to jump in on that point.
I think what we need is actually a mayor who can be less ideological about certain left or right preferences. And if it's an idea that's beneficial for the city, then you take ideas from both the left and right, you bring them together, and you make it work. And this is what we need more of in the city of Winnipeg. We need someone who's so independent that they can actually tell the province, it doesn't matter who's in government, whether it's a Conservative or an NDP government, or even a Liberal government at the provincial level, or even the federal level, that they're going to use their political capital to get their way and get what they need for their city. And I'm not convinced many of the candidates here, because they're beholden to either special interests of the business or even specific political parties, that they have that ability to do that in the long term.
All right, Ms. Ouellette, thanks very much. On the same point, Ms. Havixbeck. So you've been on council for a few years. How do you see that political party dynamic playing out with you as mayor?
Well, first of all, I know in my time on council, when somebody calls my office, I don't ask them what political card they carry. I try to deal with their issue. And I think as a mayor, that's what everybody wants in this city. They want somebody that's not beholden to developers, to big business, that didn't have a paid political lobbyists, perhaps introduce them at their launch. They don't want somebody who isn't willing to reveal their donors. They don't want somebody tied to unions. They want somebody who is going to speak up for every voice in this city. This city faces many social challenges. The poverty, the homelessness, the people without the voice in this city deserve to have a mayor who is going to represent them and who is going to put citizens' interest first.
Yeah, Marcia Marcuse wants to jump in on that point.
I just, I hear you being critical of endorsement, but isn't it correct that you sought endorsement in your own campaign?
No. I met with the Firefighters Union, and I heard what they had to say, and I could not commit to what they wanted.
So it was your decision?
And in fact, I was asked to step out of the race. So.
By?
By a number of members of the UFFW, and I chose not to because I will not be bullied by anybody.
You say a union tried to get you to step out of the race?
Yeah.
Alex Forrest did that?
The members that I met with suggested that there were too many people on the right and that perhaps some of us should step out, and I will not step out because I do not feel that I'm beholden to anyone. I have proved that in my time on council, and that's the kind of mayor I would be. The past speaks for the behavior of the future.
I want to get us I'll get us back on track with our candidate-to-candidate round.
Sorry, I think you said I was going to be able to answer that question earlier. Do you mind if I jump in? And
did I?
You did. You did. I'm sorry. Is it okay?
But keep me honest, Brian.
Is that okay?
All right,
okay. I'll just say I like some of the responses that we're hearing today in terms of about being able to work across the political spectrum. That is a very important quality for our next mayor, and something that's going to help in terms of answering your question. It's going to help work with whatever council is elected. There's good people running for council across the political spectrum. I'm prepared to work with them the way that I've done in other leadership roles. During this campaign, I've pledged that I'm not going to be a candidate in the next provincial or federal elections. I've challenged the other candidates to do that, partly because I want people to know that I'm not positioning to run for the next political position. I'm in this for Winnipeg. I'm in this for Winnipeggers. And when I've challenged Judy during this campaign, in terms of the NDP affiliation, to say that she's going to fight for our fair share, she hasn't done that when it comes to the PST. The payroll tax was introduced when she was in government, and I've simply asked, will you fight for Winnipeggers to end the job-killing payroll tax that the provincial government has? No commitment there. So the partisanship, I mean, you have to practice what you preach in terms of, you know, being able to actually work with everyone, and when it disagrees with many of the people who are working on your campaign, that's going to be a legitimate question people have, and I've been hearing on the doorsteps that people have concerns of whether or not she's going to be beholden to the NDP or not, and I think that's why I've been giving you opportunities during this campaign to say, you know what, the payroll tax was something that I brought in. I think it's wrong. We need to get rid of it, and I'm going to lobby the provincial government. I'm going to fight for our fair share. That's what Winnipeggers expect of their mayor.
All right, still in our candidate to candidate round, you're chomping at the bit over there, but yeah. As luck would have it, you're next in our candidate to candidate round. You can ask a question of anyone you wish.
Thank you. I was just going to jump in and say, I think what Winnipeggers want is a mayor who has a practical plan to deal with these very serious problems we're facing, not someone with uncosted promises. My question is for Gord Steeves. In the last election, I was honest with voters and said we needed a 2% property tax increase. Sam Cates engaged in a fear-mongering campaign and suggested people were going to lose their homes because of that. He then came into office and brought in first the frontage fee increase and then three more subsequent property tax increases. In this election campaign, I've said I'm going to be honest again, and I've proposed a 3% property tax increase, and lo and behold, my good friend Gord here is doing a Sam Cates, and he's out there fear-mongering, and he's, in fact, as I drove here tonight, there was this huge billboard suggesting Judy's going to raise your taxes by 12%. I mean, it's dishonest, and it's fear-mongering, and I'd like to know why he's engaging in these kind of tactics that only produce cynicism among our young people and the electorate.
Okay. I'm not an actuarial, but what I did is I took the 3% and I multiplied it by the 4 years. And I came up with the 12%. I would, I could run it again on my calculator if you like. I'm not sure, but if it's wrong, I blame my campaign manager. But I'm pretty sure it's right. You hadn't even said, Judy, to be fair, you hadn't even said how much you were raising taxes until I pressed you on this.
No. I said it at my very first press conference.
Well, you said inflation and population
and
so
on. Which is about 3%.
Well, 3.5%.
Oh, yeah.
No, I average it up to 3%.
Wait a second, is it 3.5? I've got to change my billboards. The question becomes, listen, good friends, and Judy and I get along well, but we don't agree on a darn thing.
It's the friendliest corner of the table, that's for sure.
How high are we going to raise taxes? And we have to understand that raising taxes is no different than running a business. When you're running a business, you can't just say, look, I have a great idea as to how we're gonna become more profitable and get more money. We're just gonna double our prices. It doesn't work that way. We have to remember, my friends, we are in competition with other cities. And these other cities, some of they don't even have, in some circumstances, a provincial sales tax. And now we hear things like a municipal sales tax coming into the discussion. All this talk about taxation and increases scares people and it scares businesses. I don't want to fearmonger, but I'm genuinely concerned that our city is not keeping up and we are not competing. And we have to compete. It's an imperative in Western Canada.
I'm sorry, sure. But we've gone way over our 60 seconds. I know it was a rhetorical question kind of to start with, but Judy, did you have a redirect on that?
Well, how do we attract businesses when our roads are a disgrace? When businesses say the biggest impediment to expanding and attracting new business to the city is the abysmal state of our infrastructure. And if we don't get our act together on that, we aren't going to grow economically, and we aren't going to keep young people here, and we aren't going to be a prosperous city. So I suggest we start with the basics, bread and butter issues, fix the roads and fix City Hall.
Was that a question for Gord Steeves?
Try it. No, and I mean, it's a classic difference in philosophies.
Yep.
If you live in Winnipeg, and I'll say it again, if you live in Winnipeg, you are among the highest, not the highest, but you're among the highest tax person in this nation. And we have to be ever mindful of that, because if we continue going on down this path, we're going to wind up in the same position as our good friends in the NDP provincial government, who have taken us from $13 billion in debt in 2001 to $31 billion in debt today. $500 million more each year. They said they weren't going to raise the PSD before the last darned election, and look what happened right after the election. We are in really difficult straits, and if God forbid something bad happens, like interest rates go up or something like that, a lot of our families are going to be stretched. And I'm not joking when I tell you that there are a lot of people out there who a tax increase is going to hurt. And we have to be careful of that. To us, it might just seem like ephemeral or numbers on a page, but for working people out there, an additional whatever it happens to be every year, every month, hurts them. And we don't want to do that.
Thanks, Mr. Steeves. Mr. Bowman, what are your thoughts on?
Well, just listening to the dynamic, if ever there were time to move from old school politics to some fresh faces at City Hall, this would be the time. Listening to the dynamic, you have somebody who's on the far right. I don't know, Gord, if you're running still in the provincial campaign or now you're running for the Reform Party or the Alliance, but you've shifted so far right, and we don't know what your position is going to be next week, let alone after the election. But you've been a supporter of rapid transit during this campaign, now you're against it. When it comes to building political bridges and having a pragmatic approach, we have someone on the left, we have someone on the right. I offer a reasonable, balanced platform to move us forward with a strong focus on jobs. I'm really proud to have the endorsement from Gary and Janice Filmon. I'm also proud to have the personal endorsement from Rana Vicari, the Liberal leader of Manitoba. And what they recognize is that it's time to get some fresh blood at City Hall.
All right, thanks, Mr. Bowman. Still on our candidate questions. There's one left, Gord Steeves. You're our last candidate to pick any one of your colleagues at the table there to ask a question.
All right, my question is for Robert-Falcon and Ouellette. Mr. Falcon, I've been watching your campaign with interest, and I congratulate you on it. I was particularly interested in one of your announcements or press releases the other day. It had to do with Brian Bowman's proposed 3-4% new municipal sales tax that he has been talking about. What is your impression, Mr. Falcon, of how a new municipal sales tax would affect people in our community?
Well, I think this is actually one of the most regressive forms of taxation we can have on working class people and also the middle class. It's very beneficial if you're in the upper classes and you're someone who makes an extreme amount of money, because when you spend your hard-earned dollars and it's spent on buying hockey equipment or even sending your kids to a summer camp, and there's taxation on that, when you add 3 or 4%, that's a bill at the end of the year which becomes very unbearable. And as someone with 5 children, I know that this is, you count your pennies, and it's very important. And it seems that in this type of form of taxation, while we need to perhaps explore different forms of revenue generation for the city, it's not one of the most beneficial types, and I think the property taxes is actually much more fair to all citizens in the city of Winnipeg.
All right, Gord, do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, no, there's been a lot of talk about taxation during the course of this campaign, and I was interested in Mr. Falcon-Ouellette's comments on it. I think that Mr. Falcon-Ouellette and I come at these things from probably different spots in the political spectrum, but it's interesting how there is almost an acknowledgement from people across the board, and it caused me great concern when the issue of a new 3-4% municipal sales tax might be put onto the table for discussion and might in fact be the direction of an eventual city council. My specific concern, to conclude, would be that once you put in place a new municipal sales tax, it can't become like the PST, where there is no guarantee that successive governments aren't going to raise it ultimately. And we could wind up with a circumstance whereby we're looking at a city like Calgary, Edmonton. Those cities don't even have a provincial sales tax, let alone the GST, an 8% PST, and now a 3 to 4% MST.
Mr. Ouellette, overtaxing?
Certainly it's very important, the amount of money that we leave in the pockets of our citizens. If we have all levels of government trying to take more and more, at the end of the day, it comes out of the same pocketbook of all our taxpayers. And so we have to be very careful about how we balance out versus the other levels of government, school boards, provincial government, and federal government.
All right, lots of talk of taxes. Will that be the ballot question? Asking my media panel now, Colin, Marcy, Bart, will that be the ballot question people go to vote on? Is who's going to raise my taxes or who's not going to?
Well, we've done polling, and the top two issues that people care about are infrastructure and integrity, cleaning up the mess at City Hall. So, obviously taxes, you can't talk about infrastructure without talking about taxes.
The other thing is, I mean, polling's polling. Some people also say they don't mind paying taxes, but obviously you take the point of people that, that can't pay them, and you get it. I think the question is, though, it's all about numbers. It's all about where the money comes from, and it's all about where we go from here. So sometimes when it comes to in relation to taxes in other cities and young people leaving because of taxes, I don't know that I connect those two things together.
Call it.
Yeah, I think that we're seeing clearly that with so many candidates that, you know, they're trying to carve it up into little bits, and we've got a bunch of different ballot questions, whether it's taxes, whether it's rapid transit, whether it's infrastructure, and, you know, we're going to have to see who manages to cobble together the greatest number of those pieces.
All right, we've been inviting comments online from people on Twitter, tweeting at Shaw TV Winnipeg, the hashtag you are mayor. Let's take one more question tonight from our Twitter audience. You have not asked your candidate a question? Hang on. Okay, let's go back. Paula Havixbeck, candidate question.
I'd like to ask my question of Mr. Steeves, because I know in his time on council, because I worked together with him, that we passed a frontage levy in 2010. Levy is the same as a tax. It's synonymous. And currently, the assessments grow in our city by 12 to 15%. That means the property values naturally go up. We get 9% more from the provincial government every year, and we now have in place a 2%, 1% towards local roads and 1% towards regional streets. And that would require two-thirds of council to undo or to make any changes to. Mr. Steeves repeatedly has commented on a tax freeze. I have said in my platform that the 2% would be there to continue on the road renewal plan. But Mr. Steeves continues to say that there will be a tax freeze. And I guess I have to wonder, does he mean he is going to attempt with this next council to obtain two-thirds of council vote in order to support undoing the 2%? And then my question would be, where would he find that money from to get these roads done? And my second question is, with the natural growth of 12 to 15% on revenues that the city generates from residential property growth, is he planning to freeze that growth so that citizens don't pay more? Because those are very important questions, and it's really putting a poor front on saying something that about freezing taxes when it actually may be beyond the mayor's control.
Oh, yes, Mr. Steeves, go ahead.
That's a more complicated question than when I had to multiply 3 times 4 to answer yours. I think there's a presumption in there, and you've mentioned this before, Paula, at different venues. Council can decide what the property tax increase is going to be by virtue of motion at budget time. And within that, it's a decision of how to allocate money within the context of the operating and capital budget. So, I mean, I don't think any of your comments necessarily change the idea that council still has to make a tough decision as to whether or not we want to increase property taxes. You can never avoid that. A comment about the expansion of the taxation base in the city of Winnipeg. When we were freezing taxes throughout the course of the 2000s, 03 to 2010, in that vicinity, as I said before, The tax base and revenues expanded by 41%. What that told me as a counselor is that if you are watching your fiscal barometer, if you're being prudent and if you're being shrewd and you're not taxing people overly, your tax base will grow. It's no different than being in business. If you keep your prices down, you'll get more customers, you will sell more.
Okay, I want to rein in there, Mr. Steeves. We're getting close on time, and I apologize, Paula.
That's okay. Can I have a follow-up question?
You do get a follow-up question,
too. That's great, because I'm sure Mr. Steeves knows from reading the budget books that every year there's a number called vacancy management, and this year in the 2014...
That's not filling jobs when they're empty.
Pardon?
That's not filling jobs when they're empty, correct?
Right, okay. And that's $14.1 million. He talked about having a fiscal barometer. Yet, I think I was the first person to actually ask the question of how many people the city of Winnipeg employed. Can he tell maybe more specifically how he feels that in his time on council he monitored that fiscal barometer and whether he questioned any of that?
Right, well, I spent months in advance of every budget going through the budget documents. I was on executive policy committee for both Mayor Glenn Murray and Mayor Sam Cates. And the process never changed. We went through the budget and we went through every detail to ensure that we were being as fiscally responsible with every budget line as we possibly could be. It was excruciating. It took hours, it took months, but it was the right thing to do. And if it's more complicated than running a household budget, obviously, but the premise is the exact same. Right now, there's a family sitting in St. James or North Kildonan or in Fort Rouge or in St. Patel, and they're going through their family budget book on their kitchen table. And they don't have the ability to just say, you know what, I want to just grab more money. We have that ability, but we have to be careful with it. That's all I'm saying.
All right, thanks, Mr. Steeves. Now, we promised to take one more question from our Twitter audience. I'm just going to see if we're ready to bring that up now. We've been asking anyone on Twitter to tweet us not only your comments on how things are going throughout the debate, but also your questions for any of the candidates. I'm just going to wait to see if this comes up. Here we are. John Dobbin asks, to all candidates, how will you stand up for Winnipeg when dealing with the premier in the province of Manitoba? This reflects back on something we were talking about before. Mr. Bowman.
Well, I think you do it from a position of respect and also a position of strength. Winnipeg is the largest center in our province. Politically speaking, it's a powerhouse. And I think any provincial government, any provincial leader is going to be working hard, as our current premier and government do, to earn the respect and confidence of Winnipeggers. The mayor's relationship with the premier over recent years has not been one that has served the citizens of Winnipeg very well. And what I would like the opportunity to do is to continue to work with our provincial partners on ways that we can move Winnipeg and also the province forward together. I've had a track record of working with our provincial government. I mentioned earlier that I was able to secure a World Trade Center license. I've got good relationships with many members of the government. And as I mentioned, have a good working relationship with members of the other parties as well. But at the end of the day, we need to demonstrate some respect, because I think it's in the provincial government's best interest that Winnipeg succeed. And I'm willing to work with whomever is there to get the job done to make sure Winnipeg is a stronger community after I'm done.
All right, thanks very much, Mr. Bowman. That concludes the last round of questions for our debate. Your mayor here, the last and only televised debate for the mayor's race in Winnipeg civic election for 2014. The last thing we're going to hear from tonight from our candidates is their closing remarks, 60 seconds each. We've heard a lot from them, a lot of interesting exchanges. This is their chance to sum up and perhaps their last chance to influence your vote. We'll start with Michel Fillion.
Conclusion. Before leaving you, I would like to mention that on October 22nd, election day, before you mark that ballot, to remember this, look behind the face. We have several people to choose from this year for mayor. You need an administrator for this position, a person that makes sure that public employees and others hired work with precision, including verification, in order to give you the services that you need. You will examine what these people are all about, what they represent, not necessarily what was presented to you. Again, look behind the face. Before leaving you, I want to mention to you the new motto at the city entrances according to my vision. My city is your city. My journey is your journey, body and soul. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mr. Fillion. We're on our closing remarks from our candidates here in our mayor, Julie Wasylycia-Leis.
Thank you very much, Peter, and thanks again to Winnipeg Realtors and to Shaw TV, and c'est un plaisir d'être ici à la Centre culturel Manitobain pour un beau dialogue avec tous les candidats. It's been an incredible evening, live televised debate that has, I think, revealed a lot of our different platforms. Clearly, there are some choices to be made. For me, this election is about someone with a practical plan and leadership that I believe I bring that to the job, someone who could fix the city and fix City Hall and make this city work again. This is an incredible city. We've got so much talent. We've got to work together and draw on that innovative spirit and build the city from the ground up. Fix our foundations and get on with the job of making this the coolest place in the country to live and do business. Finally, let me just say, I think it's that whatever people decide, it's important to vote, to cherish our democratic freedoms and to get out there and practice and exercise that democratic right. Let's support the city.
Thanks very much, Ms. Wasylycia-Leis.
Thank you.
No mistake this time. Paula Havixbeck, it's your turn for your closing remarks.
In this election, it is a pivotal time for Winnipeg. This election is when experience matters. And experience, not just sitting at the helm, not just biding time, but actually doing things, making a difference in our city. It's about working hard to represent everyone in the city. Whether they vote, whether they can't vote, whether they are impoverished, everyone in this city deserves the opportunity to succeed, and you need a mayor who will help facilitate that. Integrity matters. We saw too many scandals and too many fiascos. I have an understanding of what went wrong. I have an understanding of the recommendations and how to move our city forward. I want our city to have smooth roads, to look beautiful, to feel welcoming when people come here. I don't want to be embarrassed. I want our citizens to say, I'm proud to live here because our city has done this together. Thank you.
Thanks, Ms. Havixbeck. And our closing remarks, Brian Bowman.
Thank you very much, and thanks everyone for tuning in tonight. This election is about the future and the kind of Winnipeg that we want to build. I'm incredibly optimistic about Winnipeg's future. For far too long, we reflect on the past as if our best days have come and gone, but our best days have yet to come, and we're going to chart a new course after this election to build a stronger, more positive, and more inclusive Winnipeg, and I'm inviting all Winnipeggers to join me in that cause. My focus over this campaign has been one of growth, optimism, and hope. I've been focusing in on policies that are intended to have a city hall that works, to really focus on a growing, thriving, more modern city with stronger and safer neighborhoods. The choice is clear in this election. You can go ahead with an old school politician that will give you more of the same, or you can join me and focus on a more positive approach, an approach that is built on inclusion and optimism and hope for our future. We can do so much better as a community, and the Winnipeg way, the way that we've been able to get great things done in our community, is by working together. I'm asking for your confidence, your trust, and of course your vote on October 22nd. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Peter. And to all of those watching, I appreciate very much your listening and talking with your friends and neighbors. Please do go to our websites. Please do look at the information which is available on the various news media sites in order to make a careful decision as to who you elect on October 22nd. I love this city. I care about it very much. I've spent my life attempting to make it a better city, and in particular, a better city government. I am concerned about it, but I believe there are solutions, and I believe I've brought forward visions for what we can do in the future, which are realistic, but more importantly, I know how we can get there practically. I have not heard from the others any practical solutions which will work today. I believe they do exist, I believe we can find them, and I look forward to working with the majority of the new council to make it happen for everyone this fall.
Thanks very much, Mr. Saunders. Gord Steeves, with his closing remarks tonight.
Thank you, everybody, for your attendance and your attention. I've actually really enjoyed this evening. By now, it's probably apparent that I'm going to be freezing your property taxes, and we're and I wanted to make this a campaign about issues. And unfortunately, in this campaign, it is about issues. That's not unfortunate. But we have to make a difficult decision in our community, and it has to do with bus rapid transit. This is an incredibly expensive project for our community that is going to take up a lot of tax capacity in Winnipeg. And I am afraid to tell you, and I must tell you, that as mayor, we are not going to be able to proceed with this project. Not now. It's not the right time. It doesn't mean that we're dead set against transit or that we're bad people. It's just that we have to focus on other things. And if we do, we'll live within our means and we'll establish a city that is going to go forward and we can fix our roads and do the things that we want to do. Thank you very much for your attention. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you, Mr. Steeves. Last word tonight goes to Robert-Falcon.
Thank you very much for taking the opportunity to listen to us tonight. My team has proposed the most comprehensive plans concerning how we actually go about building a city for the long-term future of all citizens. Infrastructure is important, but there is also a social aspect to our city that has been often ignored, and it has been often ignored to our peril and detriment. We need a leader who is not only able to do the administrative side and offer that leadership, but also the inspiration to inspire populations in the city of Winnipeg, that it doesn't matter what class you're from, it doesn't matter where you live in the city, but that if you work hard, if you work with your neighbors, you can aspire to the highest position in our city. We need a mayor who is the mayor for everyone. We need someone who can unite populations. Because in 20 years, we shouldn't be discussing the social issues that are affecting the city, such as homelessness and also exclusion and the lack of a diversity in the civic workforce. We need a mayor who can bring those parts together and inspire those populations to actually believe, to bring young people into believing our city and
there,
working
Mr.
together.
We'll
so, thank you very much.
Thanks very much to all of our candidates. It's been a fantastic evening. We're very happy to have had you here. The input has been tremendous, some great debates, some great points made. Thanks very much, and good luck to everyone on October 22nd.